Hi there and welcome to Biira Online. For those of you who have not interacted with me on various social media platforms, I use the name at Joy Doreen Biira as one word, except for YouTube where I use Biira Online. So today I wanted to talk about a topic that I was invited to moderate on in Uganda. Teenagers are more sexually active than they used to be, say, during the time I was a teenager. And the problem with this is that they're doing it because they're seeking pleasure. Some of them, it's peer pressure, while for some of them, it's just a forced situation. But the result of this is that teenagers are becoming mothers at a very young age, which is costing our countries a lot of human capital, because when a girl gets pregnant, say at the age of 12, it means that her future is going to be slowed down by close to 70%, because most of these girls who are getting pregnant at younger ages live in the rural parts of our countries. Some of them are in the urban parts, but what we are seeing is that girls as young as the ages of 12 are becoming sexually active in both the rural areas and the urban areas. We have tried campaigns like abstinence, like being faithful and using a condom, but these have majorly been, say, with campaigns to do with HIV and AIDS, but we have not really addressed teenage pregnancies as teenage pregnancies and how maybe we can bring down the numbers. Because what we are seeing increasingly is that these teen pregnancies, especially in rural areas, will slow down the process or the path to economic independence for most of these girls and boys in these parts of our countries. One of the questions that we asked the participants, who were, I guess, over 500 participants at this annual dialogue, whether they think the government is doing enough to promote access to sexual reproductive health information and services in the country. And close to 75% were saying no, they don't think the government is doing enough. So it has something to do with the policies, with the laws around young people that maybe we need to rethink, because the more we actually ignore it, then we are ignoring the future of our countries, not just in Kenya or Uganda, but also across the African continent. So some of the statistics that were shared in this dialogue were shocking, yes, but they were not new. You know, for decades we've known that teenage pregnancy has been one of the things that is setting back young people's future economically and also a setback to poverty alleviation. But then again, statistics, yes. So what do we do about the statistics? If nothing is done about these statistics, it's just going to be that, statistics. So I believe that there's more that we can do, there's more that our governments can do, because if we do not do anything, then I guess we are also still going to look at a future where we are seeing more and more babies being churned out, but babies who cannot even afford to go to school because their mothers and their fathers were teenagers and they could still not afford to go to school at that time. So for me, it's really about going above and beyond just looking at statistics. You know, they say in Uganda, 44% of the teenage pregnancies are unintended pregnancies. So what does this mean? The teenagers are sexually active. Some of them are sexually active as young as 12 years old. For some, even 10, according to the reports that were being shared during this dialogue. And it is shocking, of course, to know that teenagers at this age, some of them are preteens, are already sexually active. So what is the way forward? I think that we need to have conversations about sex education, conversations about sexual reproductive health and rights, you know. We need to have conversations about the importance of having contraceptives or using contraceptives or contraception, but also consider the fact that abstinence would also help girls and boys I know this is a hard one, but it would help girls and boys to actually delay some of these outcomes like teenage pregnancies at a very young age. AFIDEP, that is an organization here in Kenya, did publish a report in collaboration with United Nations Population Fund and said that teenage pregnancy costs Kenya a lifetime GDP of 17%. Not 0%, not 1%, but 17%. So what does this mean? And I want us to just stick to that for a bit and just look at how much of a future we deny these girls and boys when they become parents at a very young age. Picture a scenario where someone becomes a mom at 14, at 15, 16, 17. Heck, I got a baby at 27. But even then, I felt young. You know, the experience is actually very overwhelming for anyone who is a mom for the first time at whatever age. So now picture a scenario where someone becomes a mom at 14. They're still trying to get a hang of what sexuality is all about. And there they are, bang, you know, they're moms. So we need to actually start to seriously think about the kind of information that is being relayed to our young people as we speak today. One in four people born in the world is born in Africa. But what kind of generations are we bringing up? You know, if we're going to look at a continent that in future is going to be poverty-free, is going to be hunger-free, is going to be one that has access to education, where we see gender equality, we need to start acting now. In 2016, there's a report that said that Uganda had one of the highest teenage pregnancy rates in sub-Saharan Africa. That has changed because today we are seeing countries like Niger, we're seeing countries like Malawi, we're also seeing countries like Angola, Guinea, Chad, that are joining in as having some of the highest teenage pregnancy rates in Africa today. But then again, you know, when you look at when you look at the cost of it, you know, the effect of teenage pregnancies, if I could just take a look at some of the reports here, that's the reason I'm holding my phone. They say the children of teenage mothers are also disadvantaged themselves in a number of ways. First of all, infant mortality rates are higher among teenage mothers' children. And due to an increased risk of developmental problems, these children often also have lessened motor and language skills in childhood than do their age-matched counterparts birthed by older mothers. So for this reason, teenage pregnancy should be seen as a problem in need of addressing and action in developing nations and the developed world alike to secure better futures for children across the globe. When a girl gets pregnant at 14, in the rural setting or in a typical African kind of way, she drops out of school. The boy might continue with school, but also it is likely that should they find out the police is involved and then maybe the boy gets arrested, he could do jail time for some time. And the baby will be born, but the baby would be born into poverty if the mother is already coming from a poor family. And this, in the long term, is going to mean that should this child grow up in this particular setting of poverty on both ends and you know, inherited poverty, then it's going to mean the child is going to grow up without access to basic services like access to water, access to education. You know, it's going to delay a whole process because in some typical African families, when you get pregnant at a much younger age, they kick you out of the house. So you have to go find, you know, where you can actually bring up the child or look for a relative who can tolerate the fact that you've gotten pregnant at a very young age, because parents are struggling to take their kids through school. So when a girl gets pregnant, it's always like, oh, you know what, I think this is it, let's now concentrate on the rest of the family who are not pregnant because you're just being a headache. You know, if we are in this kind of setting, which is usually the case in many African families and even families around the world, then it means that these girls and boys are going to have a bit of a delay in acquiring or getting to that economic independence where they can fend for themselves, where they can provide for themselves, where they can go to work, come back home, get paid for a job, or even starting businesses. Sex education is not everyone's cup of tea. Parents are so slow to talking to teenagers about sex, about the consequences, the costs of having unprotected sex. We're so oblivious to the fact that times have changed, you know. Times have changed in that when we were teenagers, when our parents were teenagers, that was a different time. When we were teenagers, that was a different time. Teenagers today, it is a different time, and we need to be aware to the fact that now things are even more difficult for them. They're dealing with too much pressure. Things as little as a cell phone could push them into having sex with someone, or if someone makes promises to them, I'm going to give you what you want, so the only thing you have to do is have sex with me, and they never think about whether it's going to be protected sex. They never think about the outcome, that they could actually get pregnant, and this pregnancy could lead to them being mothers at a very young age, which is very difficult as well. It affects the boys, especially if they are also in their teenagers. Some of them will have to serve jail time. But we also still need to encourage parents of these girls and boys and guardians of these girls and boys that when a girl is pregnant, it doesn't mean that it's the end of the world. The girl can still go back to school and learn, and she can still go back to school and become someone important. There are so many re-entry programs that they can be involved in. They can go to polytechnics where they can acquire skills that can get them the economic independence that they deserve. So we shouldn't just look at it as a situation where a girl is pregnant, that's it, drop out of school, give birth, be a mom, and then just stay home. No, that shouldn't be the case. I think it should be an issue of whether or not they are willing to go back to school, and if they are, let's support them and carry them through that situation, because it's already tough being a mom at that age. The best we can do is support them, and also support the teenage boys as well. We can do more as parents, we can do more as the government, we can do more as young people ourselves. Let's just take care of ourselves, take care of our lives. If we are sexually active, let's get the right information that we need to avoid some of these setbacks. Everybody who attended the Intergenerational Dialogue of 2019 in Kampala, thank you so much, but let's keep this conversation going, because we need to change the way things are done in our countries, in Africa. Thank you all for watching. Don't forget to subscribe, and until the next one, mwah.